I thank the organizers for inviting me to speak at this symposium.
Here's the title of my talk, From Quantum Electrodynamics to the Quark Model, some highlights of Walter Thiering's contributions to particle physics. The outline of my talk, after a very short introduction, I'll talk about quantum electrodynamics, about dispersion relations, then strong interactions in the quark model, and finally, draw some conclusions. Yeah. So here's my introduction. It's a great honor for me to speak at this symposium in memoriam of Walter Thiering. As I said, I shall try to present you some highlights of his scientific works of the years 1950 to 1970. These years saw important developments in quantum electrodynamics, in S-matrix theory, and in the mid-1960s, the quark model was introduced in hadron physics. In all these fields, Walter Thiering made seminal contributions. And I should stress, I can only pick out some highlights. I mean, you mentioned the enormous breadth of Thiering's contributions, so I will concentrate on a few highlights. So let me start with quantum electrodynamics. As you know, quantum electrodynamics originated in the 1920s, with famous works by Dirac, Heisenberg, Pauli, and others. But in many calculations, infinities appeared, and their correct treatment required the development of renormalization theory. And this happened in the late 1940s, from 1946 to 49, and the famous names connected with this breakthrough in quantum electrodynamics are Bethe, Schwinger, Tomonaga, Feynman, Dyson, and others. Thus, in 1949-1950, certainly quantum electrodynamics was one of the hottest topics a young man could work on. And note, 1950, Thiering was just 23. The earliest paper by Walter Thiering, which I could find, indeed deals with quantum electrodynamics, and it is immediately a highlight. So, he wrote it when he was in Dublin, and it says radiative corrections in the non-relativistic limit. Here is the first page, Dublin Institute of Advanced Studies, radiative corrections in the non-relativistic limit. He considered in this paper Compton scattering, the scattering of a photon on an electron, gamma plus electron goes into gamma electron. And he showed that for photon energy omega going to zero, the classical result due to Thomson is correct to all orders. To my knowledge, this was the first low energy theorem derived in quantum field theory. So I shall sketch a proof of Thiering's theorem using the by now standard methods of quantum electrodynamics. I read carefully his paper, which is very short, very condensed, as you said, but it uses the old language of the time, so I use modern language. So we consider Compton scattering, gamma plus electron going to gamma plus electron, K, K prime, P, P prime are the momenta of the particles, epsilon, epsilon prime, the polarization vectors of the photons, and SS prime, the spin indices of the electrons. And in the following, we shall work in the rest system of the initial electron, and we consider the limit that the photon energy, which is given by the scalar product P dot K over the mass of the electron, we shall consider this limit at omega goes to zero. So here is the reaction. Incoming photon, scattered photon, scattering angle theta in the lab system, the electron which gets a recoil, And Turing's theorem states that the T-matrix element for this process in the limit omega to zero is given by minus twice the renormalized charge of the electron squared, the delta function for the spin indices, and epsilon prime times epsilon for the photon polarization vector. And as Turing's theorem states, there are no higher order corrections, period. That is the exact result. And if you square it, you get the cross-section alpha squared over me squared, 1 plus cosine squared of the scattering angle over 2. Alpha, as usual, is a fine structure constant. Now, how could he manage to prove a theorem to all orders? And I sketch a proof for you. We consider the scattering amplitude, gamma plus electron, going to gamma plus electron. And then we decompose it into one particle irreducible terms. So there is one term where you have vertex function, gamma electron, giving a virtual electron that then sort of interacts in all possible ways. So it's the renormalized electron propagator, then again the renormalized vertex function. The cross diagram, and finally the diagram which is one particle irreducible, so which you cannot cut into two by cutting just one line. Yeah, so the renormalized propagator of the electron has the form 1 over p slash minus m p slash p mu gamma mu minus the electron self-energy function. And since we are dealing with a renormalized propagator, it has a pole at p slash equal m with residue 1. And that means that this remaining function here must start at second order. So it's p slash minus m, p slash minus m, times a function which is finite. And here is p slash a, a function a of p squared minus m squared, plus p of p squared minus m squared. And for the purists in mathematical physics, strictly speaking, we must introduce a small photon mass here, otherwise it would not be correct. Now, the vertex function is again related to the propagator because there is Ward's identity, which says that p slash minus p times the renormalized vertex function is given by the difference of the inverse propagators. So if you then write down for this, let me go back, yeah, the complete expression for this first diagram, what you find is, well, you have the two vertex functions, the Dirac spinners outside, the polarization vectors of the photon, and note that here I have the inverse, the renormalized propagator of the electron, which is here p plus k, k the photon momentum, minus m, minus this polarization function. And here k is in the denominator, p is essentially m, so this is naively and expected to be of order omega to the minus one, so a pole term in omega. And so you have first to show that this pole term is not here. And that you can show, as Turing remarks, since by gauge invariance we can choose epsilon and epsilon prime purely space-like, and then, working in the rest system of the electron, this, it turns out that only terms of order of the form epsilon p, epsilon prime p enter, and they are zero. So we have done with the pole terms, and we have to calculate the remaining, the constant terms. And you do this, that's a calculation which you can do, and you find that is minus 2e squared epsilon prime the photon momenta scalar product delta s prime s times a function which is not 1. It's 1 minus 2m squared times this a function at 0 minus plus 2m b function of 0. So we still have, yeah, and this was is the result if you add the two diagrams, also the cross diagram. So we still have to deal with the diagram C, the one particle irreducible one. And here comes Thiering's crucial observation, which makes the whole thing work. This has no pole terms in omega. And so we can set from the outside, from the very beginning, omega to zero. And then we obtain these diagrams, as he showed, from the electron self-energy ones by inserting on the electron lines in all possible ways a zero-energy photon. I give you an example here. This is a typical diagram for the electron self-energy. And if you and then you get these diagrams by inserting zero-energy photon lines, for instance, here on the main electron line or here on the internal electron line. And how does Thiering manage to calculate all this? You the infinite number of diagrams. Well, there is a very simple formula. Let me go back. Yeah. You see here you have propagator, just a gamma mu, in fact, the Dirac matrix and the propagator. And you can get this by this simple formula by taking the derivative of the propagator, of the electron propagator, you get essentially this zero photon insertion. And then he shows when the photons are attached to an internal electron line in all possible ways, which of course you have to do, then these contributions vanish upon loop integration. And so all what remains are the insertions on the main electron line. And if you again insert these two photons in all possible ways on the main electron line, he showed that you can write this as derivative, a second derivative of the electron self-energy function. And lo and behold, it gives you the result, minus 2e squared epsilon prime times epsilon, delta function, 1 minus n of 0. And very nicely, if you combine now everything, you get the theorem that to all orders, this Compton scattering in the limit of zero energy of the photons is given by minus 2e squared epsilon prime times epsilon delta SS prime, no higher order corrections. And this is the Thomson result. And in this way, Thiering opened the door of low energy theorems in quantum field theories at the age of 23. Distinguished followers were, for instance, Francis Lowe, with a famous paper, Bremsstrahlung of very low energy quanta in elementary particle collisions, which appeared in 58. Lowe's theorem is well known and very important whenever you have to deal with soft photons in any high energy reaction. And a very, I think, very remarkable paper by Steven Weinberg, which goes already to gravity. He says, photons and gravitons in S-matrix theory, derivation of charge conservation and equality of gravitational inertial mass from S-matrix theory. Very, I really can also recommend this paper, 64. So, to close this chapter on quantum electrodynamics, I would like to mention the excellent book which Thiering wrote on this subject, which was already mentioned by Jakob. That's there's a German version of it, which appeared in 55. And there is an English version, which was then expanded and translated by Jeremy Bernstein. And characteristics of these books and of Turing's work in general, and I completely agree with what you said, is a clear explanation of the physics of the problem with the help of simple arguments. If you really want to understand quantum electrodynamics, read the introductory chapter of Turing's book. He explains everything with a back-of-the-envelope calculation. It's really wonderful. And on the other hand, he had already at this time a mastery of precise and elegant mathematics applied then to the correct solutions of physics problems. So here is the first paper of the German version, which appeared in Vienna, Franz Teutecke, Wien. Turing was in Bern at this time. And then the English translation, Principles of Quantum Electrodynamics, and translated and by Bernstein, and it was enlarged. There was an enlarged and version taking into account of the developments, which were very quick, in quantum electrodynamics in the 50s. So much for quantum electrodynamics. So the next important chapter of Turing's work in particle physics I would like to cover are dispersion relations. And in this section, I shall discuss two papers which were co-authored and authored by Turing. The first one, together with Gell-Mann, Goldberger, and Turing, says the use of causality conditions in quantum theory, appeared in 54, and then a lecture series, in fact, dispersion relations, which appeared in Novocimento in 59. I shall mostly concentrate on the first paper, Gell-Mann, Goldberger, Turing, which appeared at a time when S-matrix theory was at the focus of theorists. But the general reduction formalism due to Lehmann, Szymanczyk, and Zimmermann appeared only a year later. So it was not yet available for them. And this paper was one of the last fundamental papers appearing in German, in fact. It was in Novocimento, but it's really, it's nice to read for me because it's in German. Yeah. Okay. So here are, again, the first pages, use of causality conditions in quantum theory and dispersion relations. So the purpose of the work of Gell-Mann, Goldberger, and Turing is best stated in the abstract. So I will go back and read the abstract for you. I hope you can. Anyway, I will read it for you. It says, the limitations on scattering amplitudes imposed by causality requirements are deduced from the demand that the commutator of field operators vanish if the operators are taken at points with space-like separations. The problems of the scattering of spin zero particles by a force center and the scattering of photons by a quantized matter field are discussed. The causality requirements lead in a natural way to the well-known dispersion relation of Cramer's and Kronig. A new sum rule for the nuclear photo effect is derived, and the scattering of photons by nucleons is discussed. So, again, I will only give you a sketch of how these three famous people solved this important problem. And I will concentrate on the first example, which they give, which they say is very simple, but that already was complicated enough. So, as they say, we consider the scattering of a scalar relativistic particle of mass mu on a fixed static radially symmetric potential of finite range. And I will assume for simplicity that the potential is only repulsive, which makes life a little bit easier, and that it vanishes, the potential vanishes, for x vector absolute bigger than a certain number, a over 2 bigger than 0. Now, let the field corresponding to the particle be phi of x. Then the field equation is d'Alembert plus mu squared plus 2 mu, the potential, phi of x equals 0. And the causality requirement is that these field operators, this commutator of the two field operators, vanish if x and y are space-like to each other. In my metric, it's x minus y squared less than 0. Well, in the standard Bjerkendrell metric. It is certainly not obvious how to come from there to an analyticity property of the forward scattering amplitude. And this is also stressed in the second paper in this dispersion relation lectures by Turing. And he remarks that usually sharp edge conditions in quantum field theory are related to multi-particle states. Because if you squeeze sort of the wave function of a single particle too much, you get automatically more particles. And so it's remarkable that you get from a sharp edge condition, with a sharp edge on the light cone, of course, an analyticity property for a single particle effect, for the scattering of a single particle. Now, I shall try to give you a sketch of Gell-Mann-Goldberger-Turing's solution for this above example of scattering on a potential. So, a starting point, we consider the classical solutions of the field equations. So it's all very elementary, in fact, and surprising how far they got this essentially very elementary method. So we get positive and negative frequency solutions, phi plus minus e to the plus minus I omega x zero, times the space part. And of course, these classical solutions satisfy the same equation as the field operator, d'Alembert plus mu squared plus 2 mu, the potential, times this classical solution equals 0. So if you separate off the time dependence, you find the field equation for the space part, the Laplace operator, plus 2 mu, the potential, minus k squared, times the space part equals 0, where k squared is omega squared minus mu squared. And now you do what you all do in quantum mechanics course and explain to your students. You separate angular and radial dependences. Here are the spherical harmonics and then the radial function. And x hat is the unit vector in the direction of x. And now, Gell-Mann, Goldberg, and Turing use the finite range assumption for the potential. And this means that if this x vector is bigger than the range of the potential, you have the free waves. And you can write this complete wave then as the free ingoing wave plus a free outgoing wave, but which carries the phase shift which it has experienced in the potential. Now, the free waves are the spherical Hankel functions, which have, these are the exponential functions for large value, for large argument. And here, so if the exact decomposition of the complete radial function for outside of the range of the potential, the Hankel function 2 plus the Hankel function 1, and here is the phase shift, e to the 2i delta L of k. Now, the usual scattering amplitude, that's of course what they aim at, is obtained. You have the incoming wave, the scattered wave with momentum k prime, the scattering angle theta, here's the potential, and then the scattering amplitude is function of the momentum absolute k, and the scattering angle theta is the sum of all partial waves, 2L plus 1, the Legendre polynomial, and the partial amplitude, which is 1 over 2IK times e to the 2I delta L of k minus 1. So all this is quantum electrodynamic, this is quantum mechanics course. The next step is to expand the field operator in terms of creation and annihilation operators. Although this is standard, here are the classical functions and the annihilation and creation operators, which satisfy, if you have this radial expansion, a commutation relation like this. Delta k minus k prime, the delta ll prime, delta ml prime. Where l and m are the usual angular momentum quantum numbers. Now, Gell-Mann, Goldberg, and Thiering consider a retarded Green's function. So here you have the commutator of the field operators multiplied by the theta function, and we know from causality that this should be zero for space-like separations. And of course, due to the theta function, it's also zero if x0 is less than y0. And now, this retarded function can be calculated for if the space arguments of x and y are bigger than a over 2 in terms of the phase shifts, because there we have the function at our hand. And, of course, the phase shifts or the partial amplitude. And this is a rather lengthy calculation, I can tell you, which I will not reproduce here. No, don't worry. I shall only give you the result for x and y equal r over 2, which, of course, should be bigger than a over 2, so outside the range of the potential. X and y diametrically opposite. That turns out to give you then the forward scattering amplitude. And x0 minus y0, t bigger than 0. And what they find then is that the retarded Green's function, the complete retarded Green's function, gives you the free term, which of course fulfills all the causality requirements, plus a remainder. And of course, the remainder is the important term. And they can calculate this remainder for r bigger than t, which is then the space-like separation, as it turns out. And it gives, they can represent this as an integral over omega. Omega is k squared plus mu squared, times e to the I root omega squared minus mu squared minus omega times r, e to the I omega z. Z is r minus t. And here, this capital F is the forward scattering amplitude for omega bigger than mu, and the complex conjugate of the forward scattering amplitude for omega less than minus mu. And here, there's a little bit of fishy in the argument. They say they hope that it can be continued smoothly for this interval here. And now they make use of a mathematical theorem, so mathematics, of course, enters, Titchmarsh theorem, which says that if you have such a function, which is zero for all z bigger than zero, then this function here is analytic in the upper half omega plane and bounded there. That's Titchmarsh theorem. And it's easy to convince yourself that this exponential function, in fact, goes to one in the upper half plane of omega. And so they show that f of omega is bound, is a bounded analytic function, and therefore f of omega satisfies the dispersion relation. And then they go on to extend this proof to scattering of photons on a particle. But you can understand that this proof also works there, because in the forward direction, the potential doesn't get any recoil momentum. So it doesn't matter if you have a fixed potential or if you have a particle there which doesn't get a recoil. And note, they did not have the general reduction formula at their disposal, so they constructed a sort of reduction formula by themselves. Now, applications, which are also mentioned in the abstract, for instance, Compton scattering on a helium 4 nucleus for simplicity, gamma plus helium 4, gamma plus helium 4, then from the dispersion relation you get that the real part of the forward scattering amplitude is given by minus 4 alpha over m, m the mass of the nucleus, plus omega squared over 2 pi squared, the principal value of this integral, which involves the total cross-section. And here I use, of course, the optical theorem that the imaginary part of the forward scattering amplitude is related to the total cross-section. And here this term, f of 0, is due to Thiering's theorem, which I mentioned in the first part. It's given by minus 4 alpha over m, Thiering's theorem, the Thomson limit. Now, so, Gold, as I said, Gell-Mann, Goldberg, and Thiering were the first to show the connection between causality requirement and dispersion relations. So again, they opened the door in particle physics, where since then, dispersion relations have become an absolutely standard tool for many applications, for many theoretical analysis. Pionuclear forward scattering, yeah. Fixed D dispersion relations are important for all phase shift analysis, which have been done extensively. At this old times, there was the N over D method, which specifically used this dispersion relation. Still a very good method. Also, they had very important followers. Landau in 1959 published a very important paper on dispersion relations. And the title of his paper was the analytic properties of vertex paths in quantum field theory. There he introduced what's now called the Landau conditions, which are used very often for if you study Feynman diagrams. The same was apparently done by, at the same time, by Bjørkheim. In his doctoral dissertation in Stanford, that is cited in this famous book by Bjørkheim and Trell on relativistic quantum fields. So that was, in my opinion, an absolute, as I said, they opened the door wide, and since then people use it, maybe without knowing that Gell-Mann, Goldberg, and Thiering were the first who introduced this. All right, so, last topic, strong interactions in the quark model. In 1962, Henley, famous physicist from University of Washington in Seattle, and Thiering published a book, Elementary Quantum Field Theory. That's also a very interesting book. It has many interesting discussions of the general physics of quantum field theory. Again, you get a lot of physical insight studying this book. As applications, they discussed pion physics, pion nucleon physics, nuclear physics. I can show you again the first page of this book, Elementary Quantum Field Theory, Henley and Turing. Then he was already in Vienna. He says, Director, Institute for Theoretical Physics, University of Vienna. However, soon after this book appeared, there was what I would call the quark revolution in particle physics. Before this revolution, people thought that the basic quanta which govern particle physics are bare pions, bare nucleons, and so on. And after this revolution, we still think that the basic quanta describing hadron physics are unobserved objects, quarks, carrying fractional charges. To my knowledge, three people independently introduced this idea of fractional charged objects as basic quanta in hadron physics. You may not know about André Petermann, who published a paper in French, Propriété de l'étrangeté, une formule de masse pour les maisons vectorielles. It appeared in 65, but note that it was received in 63 on the 30th of December. So physicists at this time already, they didn't know holidays. Then Gell-Mann published his paper, A Schematic Model of Baryons and Mesons, in Physics Letters, received 4th of January 64. And Zweig, an SU3 model for strong interaction symmetry and its breaking, which appeared as a CERN preprint 17th of January 64, and an expanded version 21st of February 64. So, a very short period when these fundamental papers on sort of this idea having fractionally charged objects for hadron physics. The assumption from now on was that mesons are quark antiquark bound states, baryons are three quark bound states. Yeah, as you know, Zweig was not allowed to publish this, so it was only published 20 years later. But that's a different story. So at this time, what we now call three quark flavors were introduced, up, down, and strange, with charges two-thirds, minus a third, minus a third, and they have spin one-half. Soon thereafter, the SU6 model was introduced, where it's assumed that the forces between quarks are, in a first approximation, independent of quark flavor and spin. And this was done by Sakita, supermultiplets of elementary particles, and Gürsey and Radicati, spin and unitary spin independence of strong interactions. Turing immediately took up these new developments, and already at the Schladming Winter School, very nice school at this time, really very nice, he presented lectures on the quark model. So I think, yes, I have already first page of his lectures, Schladming 65. Electromagnetic properties of hadrons in the static SU6 model. Walter Turing, Institute for Theoretical Physics, University of Vienna. At this time, people frequently used, instead of up, down, strange, as we use today, P and lambda for these quarks. So here you have the charges, two-thirds, minus a third, minus a third. what he gives in these lectures are very nice table of wave functions of the known hadrons of the time in terms of these quarks. So here, for instance, what a phi meson or a pi plus meson is a n with spin up, proton with spin down, minus a an n quark with spin down, p quark with spin up. So the basic states in this SU6 model are the six states: up quark with spin up quark with spin down, and so on. D with spin up, D with spin down, S with spin up, S with spin down. In 1966, Thiering lectured again at Schladming on this triplet model of elementary particles, and he published a paper together with Herbert Pitchman in Physics Letters on the subject. Their focus was on the electromagnetic and weak decays of mesons in the quark model. And yeah, here's Schladming 66, triplet model of elementary particles by Walter Thiering. And here's the Physics Letters of Pitchman and Thiering. It says, predictions of a static quark model on boson decays. So I will only pick an example of the decays which they discussed. And this example is the weak decays of pi plus to mu plus mu mu and a mu neutrino, and compared to k plus mu plus mu mu. So these two decays. Already at this time, it was known that these are low energy effects. They are governed by an effective weak interaction. So here you have a mu and a mu neutrino coupled with a V minus A current. Here the U D bar current, U S bar current. And nowadays we write here the elements of the Kabibo-Kobayashi-Maskawa matrix. In 66, of course, this was not yet known. So one here was, in 66, the cosine of the Kabibo angle and the sine of the Kabibo angle. Now, what are the diagrams which describe these decays? In the quark model, the pi plus is a U d bar bound state. Now, we have the weak decay. The U and the d bar have to come together to a point, because this is a four Fermi point interaction. And then it can decay into a mu neutrino and a mu plus. And similarly, the k plus is a U s bar bound state. U s bar come together and decay into nu mu and mu plus. The leptonic parts of these diagrams are easily calculated. So the hadronic part here is governed by what's called the pseudoscalar decay constant, f pi and fk. So just by kinematics, the pi plus, which goes to the vacuum with the weak current here, the weak hadronic current in between, must be proportional to the momentum of the pion times a constant, this decay constant f pi, and similarly for the kaon. The decay rates are, of course, given by g. G here is, but it was written, g is Fermi's constant, known since the 30s. So you have g, the element of the Kabibo-Kobayashi-Maskawa matrix, the decay constant, all squared, and then kinematic factors, m pi, mu squared over 8 pi, 1 minus mu squared over m pi squared squared, and similarly for the kaon here. So if you insert here the Fermi constant, the absolute values of the weak matrix element of the CKM matrix element from other sources, you find that f pi is around 130 MeV, fk around 155 MeV, and pi on Mars is 140. So in the first approximation, f pi is roughly the same as fk and is roughly m pi. And now we come to the calculation of f pi and fk in the non-relativistic quark model, assuming, as Pitchman and Turing did at this time, that pi plus and k plus are weakly bound states of ud bar and us bar quarks. And from the diagrams which I had, it is clear that these constituents have to come together on one point, so these diagrams must be proportional to the wave function at the origin. Bound state wave function at the origin, oops, which has a mass, which has a dimension mass to the 3/2. And so then the calculation essentially is very easy. We just use dimensional analysis. And this says that f pi must be 1 over root m pi times the wave function at the origin, and similarly the fk, 1 over root mk times the wave function at the origin. And with f pi, roughly fk, we get that this ratio of the wave functions at the origin is square root of m pi over mk, which numerically is 0.53. Pitchman and Turing phrased this in terms of effective radius, defining an effective radius for the pion as the wave function to the minus 2/3, and rk, similarly, the wave function at the origin for the k to the minus 2/3. And then the ratio of this radii, of this effective radius, comes out to 1.52. And note, in the strict SU6 limit, these numbers should be 1. And this is a rather large deviation from 1. Typically, one expected at this time 20% deviation, but not 50%. And this was also found by later, in fact, by Weisskopf and van Rooyen, and was called the Pitchman-Turing-Weisskopf-van Rooyen paradox at this time, and played a rather important role then. Now, what is the status today? Today, these constants are calculated very accurately in lattice gauge theory, QCD lattice gauge theory, and from last year in particle data group, you find this number 130.2 with an error of 1.7 MeV. Amazing, yeah, absolutely amazing. FK 155.6 with an error of even less, 0.4 MeV. And these numbers are then taken as input in global determinations of this Kabibo Kobayashi Maskawa matrix elements from this pion and kaon decays and many other reactions. So that brings me to my conclusions. In my contributions to this symposium, I have tried to remind us of only some highlights of Walter Turing's contributions to particle physics. The clear evidence of his standing in the world of particle physics was that he had the honor to be chairman of the 14th International Conference on High Energy Physics, which was held here in Vienna in 68. And here's the first page, sponsored by the Austrian federal government, very generously. And here's chairman of the organizing committee, Walter Turing. And he thanks all the people and institutions who made this conference possible. Now, I looked, when I prepared this talk, at the lists of speakers and participants of this conference. And one sees that the cream of particle physicists attended this conference. And so chairing this conference certainly was another highlight of Turing's involvement in particle physics. And I have copied a list of the people who attended, a very, very partial list of the people who attended this conference. And note that there were three Nobel Prize winners of the time, which had already the Nobel Prize at the time. These were T.D. Lee, C.N. Yang, and Emilio Segre. And all the rest, 15, were at this time future Nobel Prize winners. Bert Richter, Tink, Weinberg, Cronin, Fitch, the discoverers of CP violation, Gell-Mann, with whom Turing had collaborated, Glauber, Goldberger, of course, Peter Higgs also was there, Leon Ledermann, Nambu, Wolfgang Paul, Salam, Steinberger, Ken Wilson, and also George Zweig. So if you look at it, it's absolutely amazing. There was also Weisskopf, there was Geoffrey Bright here, there was Veneziano here. So really the cream of particle physics was there in Vienna in 68. And you allow me a side remark, 68 was politically not such a good year. There was the invasion of Czechoslovakia just a few months before. So my gratitude goes to Walter Turing for the privilege I had to be a student. And thank you for the attention.